Hey, what's up guys, Jeremy here. In this video, let's talk about robot speed and acceleration. Let's get started. For many applications, making sure that the tool is moving at a given speed with respect to the part is very important. So let's see how RoboDK handles that. So here I have the same exact station as I was using in the last video. So if we simply run, let's say we simply run the pick and place here. So the pick and place is just for the moment a bunch of move J bundled together. If you go to parameters in your robot panel, you will see here at the top of your screen you have speed, acceleration, joint speed, and joint acceleration. So this is where most of the informations are. This is not necessarily where you will modify those information, but this is where you can see where the state of the speed and acceleration of the robot at a given time. So here, everything related to speed in millimeters per second and acceleration in millimeters per second square are linked generally with move L's. And when it comes to joint speed in degrees per second and joint acceleration in degrees per second square, this is linked to move J's. So there's a few nuances there, but we'll come to that later in this video. So right now, as you remember, we have a rounding value of -1, meaning that we need to stop at each point and restart afterwards. So our speed profile will look like an acceleration, linear acceleration, maximum speed, linear deceleration. That is if we are able to reach the maximum speed, because there's always a possibility that we have a triangular profile instead of a trapezoidal one, just because our acceleration is in high enough, or because the distance between the two points is in far enough for us to reach that maximum speed. So in this case here, if I run the program, you will see, let's say, at which speed it's running. If I press escape to stop it and I go for 500 in terms of joint speed and then I run it, you should see that it's a bit faster, but we are clearly limited by our acceleration. Our acceleration is just 150 degrees per second, and most of those pieces of pad here takes less than a second, so we wouldn't have the time to go for half a second of acceleration and half a second of deceleration would only give us something like 75 degrees per second. So we are not reaching the 500. So before we were at 50 degrees per second, and now in reality, we only reach 75. But if I was to kind of crank that up to, I don't know, 1,500 and then run the pick main again, now you would see that it makes a big difference, because our speed profile, instead of being like this, will be more like that. So that's a very important part to consider, that acceleration will play a big role in the actual speed you reach and therefore your cycle time, especially if the points are relatively close to one another. If I was to take all those here moves and switch them to linear motion, now the speed and acceleration here in millimeters per second would prevail, and this is what would kind of affect the speed of our tool. So here it's very, very slow, painfully slow, in fact. So if I go here and I go for a meter per second, run this here, it's a bit faster, but again, we reach the same kind of limit where here our acceleration is in high enough for us to kind of take full advantage of the speed we are requesting. So if I go here and set 2000, millimeters per second square, then I run this one here, you will see the difference. On the other end, if I was to have 200 here, I'm just gonna make it run once again so that you can have a feel of how it goes and how fast it goes, so not that fast. And if I had here a rounding of anything over one, so not -1, and then I was to run that here, it would be way faster, because in this case, because as I said, with any rounding, RoboDK will keep the velocity of the tool at all time, even if the path is let's say going in one direction and then the other direction the other way, it will keep 100% of the velocity. It's not exactly how it would behave in the real world, but it's how RoboDK behaves. So it's more important for you to understand how RoboDK behaves than expect RoboDK to behave exactly as a real robot would. So that's the first thing. You can change the velocity and acceleration from here, but you can also change it by adding a set speed instruction. So if you add a set speed instruction, you will have those this window here appearing. By default, it's only checked set speed. So let's say that we enter a value that doesn't make sense, just so that you can see the effect. So if I go 9999 and then I run this here, now it's super, super fast. If I go parameters, you will see that the 9999 was applied directly here. So instead, if I go for 100, click OK, the 100 is applied here. And if I go to parameters here, it changed parameters. So if you don't have access to parameters here with your version of RoboDK, with your license, you can always affect the speed and acceleration instruction of the robot. If I go here, edit, I can decide to modify the acceleration, the speed in degrees per second and speed acceleration, just like that. And then either run the program or just double click here. If I double click here, parameters, the exact values I had in the set speed instruction will be applied to my robot here. Before we finish with this module, I wanna go back to the singularity example. Remember what I was saying regarding the fact that if you go near a singularity, you should see a slowdown of the tool or of the robot because of that limit you're reaching for the joints. If you don't change any settings in RoboDK, you won't see that, because RoboDK by default, to improve the look of your simulation, won't consider the slowdown of the robot when you are going near singularity or if you even reach the limit of the joints. So if I go here and I say, okay, KUKA, no wrist and near singularity, the linear profile or the speed profile is linear. So linear acceleration, max speed, linear deceleration. Same goes for if I go KUKA, no shoulder singularity, it's the same speed all the way here. But if you go to tools and then options, and then motion, here you have move time calculation, linear versus joint speed. By default, it's linear for move L and joints for move J. But if you see here, you have linear constraint, joint constraint, shortest time. Honestly, I never used those three. But here, if I want to have an accurate cycle time, or at least as accurate cycle time estimation as possible, I will use strictest constraint, and you will see the difference. If I run the no wrist singularity, you see here, it's moving relatively fast and then it's slowing down. If it's even more, it's easier to see here. It's moving at a certain speed, then it's slowing down because it reaches the limit of the joints, either 4 or 6, and then it's picking up back and re-accelerating. So that options here under tool options motion should always be activated if you try to have, or if you try to calculate the cycle time of your setup. So that's a good segue to our next video. So the next video will be talking about cycle time estimation, how you can have the best possible cycle time estimation, and how to retrieve that information. So I hope it was helpful. In any case, have a great day, guys. Thank you.